Okay, so thank you very much. So I have a dual status. So as one of the organizers, I should thank to all the participants who have already left and who will be leaving very soon for coming here and making actually this happen. So thank you very much. So secondly, as a many year collaborator and a friend of Maxim, I should follow the tradition and to say a few words. So I should recall when we meet, what happened, but probably, I mean, it's too many words about how someone met Maxim first time. So I'll just, when preparing this talk, I just tried to recall a couple of episodes, kind of a snapshots from my memory. And I recall three which demonstrate Maxim's broadness and power in mathematics. Amazing thing that all these three recollections, they happened within the 1 year framework. I just tell you just in one or two phrases, and people who know what happened after, what was the development, they will really understand. First recollection, it happened in the old building of Max Planck Institute on the other, not the new one. And I also remember it by heart. Yeah, and I remember Maxim met me in the corridor and asked whether I knew, whether I met the formula for the number of rational curves in CP2 passing through the fixed number of points. This was one, okay, yeah. Second, it was, I was visiting at Institute for Advanced Study, and I discussed with Deligne deformation quantization. He was interested in the subject at that time and even wrote a paper later. And so one day I received an email from Maxim, which says that the Hochschild, Hochschild cohomological complex of an algebra of functions on say Poisson manifold must be a formal differential graded Lie algebra. All right. So I told to Deligne, he didn't believe, he made computation, still didn't believe, but as we know, all this deformation quantization story, so Maxim was right. I think he does. And the last one, it happened, I think I was visiting at MIT and I attended some seminar course given by Yuri Manin, and the day before the seminar, I received an email from Maxim, which basically contained just one phrase, I understood mirror symmetry. And so it was something like maybe 92, year 92, so I told to Manin, so he was shocked by this news. And a few months later, there was Arbeitstagung, where Maxim gave his talk, which about what is now known as homological mirror symmetry. All right, so these three stories. And now back to the subject of my talk, which of course is also grew out, or rather maybe probably just small part of what we did with Maxim. It's about cohomological whole algebras. Their representation. So this notion was introduced in our joint paper with Maxim. I think this is an archive reference. Now it's published. And I would like to put it, the subject of my talk, in a little bit unusual perspective, connecting to Maxim's lecture. There was like a couple of years ago, Victor Katz was visiting at IHS, and there was a kind of a half day devoted to his, I forgot, 70, yeah. And Maxim gave a talk about the certain similarities between geometry of vector space endowed with symmetric and with skew-symmetric form. So mainly he was motivated probably by this notion of wall crossing structures, which we were developing at the time. And so I would like to kind of speculate that cohomological Hall algebra is something which appear on the skew-symmetric side of some story, on the symmetric side of which we have kind of a conventional or constructible Hall algebras or Katz-Moody algebras. And to make it, maybe it's just completely not true, but it's maybe not. So so if we have, let me just explain a little bit. Suppose we have a quiver, like an oriented graph, finite graph. This is a set of vertices. And and suppose we are interested in finite dimensional representations of the quiver. So say over complex numbers or finite field, it really doesn't matter. To each vertex we associate vector space of some dimension, and to each arrow a linear map. So then we have dimension vectors, which are just collections of non-negative integers, and the Euler form, or Euler Ringel form, as people say, associated with this quiver. So in general, it's indeed Euler form on the K-theory. In this case, the category has homological dimension 1. And it can be computed entirely in terms of the dimension vectors. So this is collection, say, and gamma 2 is a similar one. So that's the formula, something like this. This is the number of arrows between vertices I and j. So it's neither symmetric nor skew-symmetric, so there are two possibilities. We can it symmetrize or skew-symmetrize. So if we symmetrize, so then we can associate the corresponding Katz-Moody Lie algebra. And it has a triangular decomposition into the negative diagonal Cartan and positive part. And one can quantize the positive part of the direct sum of Cartan and the positive part intrinsically. This is Ringel's idea. For that one need to consider representations of the quiver over finite field. So finite field, and construct the whole algebra. So whole algebra, which is basically algebra of functions with finite support on the stack of of the abelian category of this representation. So if we have two functions with finite support, for example, delta functions, so it's constructible version, then the product is defined up to some normalizing factor for which there is some ambiguity. So it's basically sum over all possible extensions. Geometrically, it can be interpreted in terms of certain Hecke-type operators, because here we consider flags of an object and a subobject, so you can imagine that this is a kind of a Hecke-type construction. And so what we get in the end, that this whole algebra gives us a quantization on its quantum group in the sense. You want me to be very pedantic or to... Okay, so you consider the subalgebra, which corresponds to, say, simple to representations with a dimension vector of this type. Like simple representation, you generate the subalgebra, so those give you Chevalier generators in the quantum groups and so on, so on. So this is a kind of a very, very classical story. It's an industry with many names, starting with Ringel. So I really do not want to give the full list of names and even the partial list of names. But what I would like to mention that this constructible whole algebra, let me call this constructible whole algebra, so it appears in real life, in geometry, not only in algebra, when one... No, yeah, it's impossible. On the what people would say, or physicists would say, on the instanton side, of geometric engineering. Namely, one consider torsion-free shifts, on P2 of a fixed rank with fixed framing at the infinite line. So this gives some moduli space, actually collection of moduli spaces, which depends on the rank of rank R, and on the second Chern class. For R equal 1, one basically get just a Hilbert scheme of C2. And so on the direct sum, one get an action of Hecke operators, kind of a Hecke operators, and representations of algebras which are closely related to constructible whole algebras appear. This is the work of many people, including Nakajima, Schiffman, Moissero, think maybe more recently Akunkov probably I should mention Kapranov in relation to the whole algebras associated with curves. Anyway, this is what I would like to think of the story associated with the symmetric. Well, it's kind of a Nakajima quiver varieties, yeah? So then we first should symmetrize. So we basically in dimension two, there are kind of a nearby Calabi-Yau. So then the bilinear forms are symmetric. Now, on the Calabi-Yau side, so in geometric engineering, in physics, so the original idea was to compute or to, I don't know, to model the spectrum of certain four-dimensional gauge theory in terms of the string theory. And it's not well understood mathematically, but there are some nice coincidence of certain generating functions. For example, for like kind of a classical story, for r equal 1, here one can consider the generating function, but not just of the cohomology of Hilbert scheme, but equivariant cohomology of Hilbert scheme with respect to this torus. And this equivariant cohomology generating function, like the, it coincides with the generating function or with partition function, as physicists will say, of certain three-dimensional Calabi-Yau. For r equal 1, it will be the resolved conifold, the total space of rank 2 bundle O minus 1 plus O minus 1 on P1. So then, it's a kind of a very instructive and stimulating idea. Yeah, this run. Yes, absolutely. If you change the rank, you change your Calabi-Yau. So it's like you have something with, I think, A or maybe AR singularity, and then you resolve. So that's what. Yeah. So what's happened on the Calabi-Yau side? So this Maxim, of course, remembers very well, but not everyone maybe in the room knows. So let me briefly recall its cohomological whole algebra story. The idea of cohomological whole algebra, so I abbreviate it with this, it's the following. If we have it's very general. So if we have a three-dimensional Calabi-Yau category, so we have a duality, third duality in dimension three, so then the Euler form alternating sum of dimensions of X group is Q-symmetric. It's Q-symmetric for any odd-dimensional Calabi-Yau. Yeah. All right. And so basically, three-dimensional Calabi-Yau category, it's kind of an analog of the algebra endowed with a scalar product. It's indeed like if it had one object, it would be Calabi-Yau algebra. So then for any object here, one can define the potential, kind of a generalized Chern-Simons where I have these brackets which is a scalar product or pairing, Calabi-Yau structure. The objects and these are higher composition maps because everything is A infinity in this story. So this is a potential. And alpha is in general is an element of degree one. So then it can be thought as a function, as a partially formal function, kind of defined in the, it's an intuition, it's an idea, it's not very precise, but it's useful. So as a function defined in the formal neighborhood of the space of objects. So then one can hope that if one has a function, so which actually, for which objects belong to the critical set, just look for the sheaf of vanishing cycles. And so kind of informally, the space where the product structure should exist should be the cohomology of the, actually it's a stack, it's not something nice, it's a stack of objects, and this is the sheaf of vanishing cycles. Yeah, that's, so I compactly supported, then you should dualize, that's true. But anyway, ideally we would like to have such an algebra which exists even in a triangulated framework. And so this goal is not achieved, but there are some special cases which appear in the nature, in applications, and it's a framework in which we did define this cohomological whole algebra. It's very explicit. So it's a quiver with a potential. So quiver is an oriented graph, and the potential, let's work over complex numbers, it's a polynomial in arrows of the quiver, which is cyclically invariant. If there are no cycles, then the potential must be equal to zero. And so this kind of a wish or desire, in this particular case, it indeed becomes a theorem, which says that if we consider the graded vector space, it will be the sum over all dimension vectors. So, because a stack of objects is a disjoint union over all overall dimension vectors of equivariant cohomology, compactly supported, if you wish. Here I have a representation space of dimension gamma with the coefficients in the sheaf of vanishing cycles. And if I have a cyclically invariant polynomial, then the trace is well defined. So I have a regular function. Now some shifts. I introduce this Euler form. It should be the shift by the value of the Euler form on this vector. And so I have dualize. Yeah, I think this is it. So this is actually the same, but now it has a meaning. And so the claim is that this this graded vector space, in fact, it has more than just the grading with respect to the weight lattice, with respect to the dimension lattice, but the claim is, so H carries an associative algebra structure.
Yeah, but you jumped from Calabi-Yau into category to quiver and didn't quite explain.
Ah, yeah, you're right. So if you have, you see, in this case, it's category of homological dimension one, And you can use, you can extend it, adding x2. I mean, there is an algebraic way to do it. You can add x3 and x2 and x3 such that this will be, these two spaces will be dual. These pairs will be dual. It's like in geometry, like if you have a curve, you should know, I mean, physicists especially like it. If you have a curve, you can, for example, construct a three-dimensional Calabi-Yau, starting with something one-dimensional. So there are several ways to do it in geometry. But anyway, the product comes, so the product on H, it comes indeed from the Hecke correspondences. So we consider, so that's a diagram. Or maybe let me do it this way. It's pi 1 cross pi. Ah, okay. Pi 2. And basically, okay. So this is a space of flags. Of representations of these dimensions. And this is a space of representations of dimension gamma 1, representation of dimension gamma 2. So then the projection, this projection maps the flag into the quotient. Yeah. This is the left, and the right is, of course, the projection to the middle term. So exactly as in the definition of constructible whole algebra, and so this pullback push forward construction gives an associative product. So of course one has to prove it. Okay. So then there are several versions of cohomological whole algebra. So for categorical purposes, one has to use the sheaf of vanishing cycles, but in fact, what we have, if you see, we have some algebraic scheme, whatever, x, and the function on it, a regular function, so any cohomology theory for such a pair will give you a version of cohomological whole algebra. And we considered all of them. For example, you can take like relative cohomology, something like this, or maybe even just this. Okay, so anyway.
Yeah, as I said, didn't that make connection between this, you can start the space objects with a function, and then this cohomological whole algebra, what did you want to say? You see, you have upstairs this.
No, I want to say that in general, in order to define algebra structure, first I need to define the space, and the space is cohomology with coefficients of sheaves of vanishing cycles on some function. In three-dimensional Calabi-Yau, it's a kind of a, in geometry, you heard it from Richard Thomas talk that there is some perfect abstraction. So like your space of objects, if you can make it even in the moduli space, it's a space of critical points of some function. So this is a sort of a sticky version. So I want to have some potential and ideally to define it in a very general framework for any inconstructible Calabi-Yau, three Calabi-Yau category with some conditions like orientation data. So I don't know how to do it in general, nobody knows. But there are some examples where it can be done. One example is a quiver with a potential. It defines the three Calabi-Yau category by means of Ginzburg construction. Okay, you can even assume that the potential is zero, then you still can make it into three Calabi-Yau, then you get just a cohomology, equivariant cohomology of the representation spaces, so it's, which is much simpler. But in all the cases, for example, if W is zero, yeah, so you can use Hecke-type diagram to produce an associative product. It's not really a subject of my talk. It's just.
But how is this algebra related to the first one you gave?
I didn't give you, no, I didn't give you any algebra. It's a kind of a.
No, to constructible, no relation.
Ah, to constructible, no relation. It's similar, yeah. Yeah.
It's very, very absolutely different in very simplest examples. Sorry.
No, that's the whole point. Yeah. So it's something which sits on the.
Even this one sort of has Qs in it, right? The cohomology is created by Qs.
Oh, it's not just. I mean, in general, it's an object of some category, tensor category of exponential Hodge structures, because you see there is a Hodge structure on the cohomology. So it's. It has not just one gradient. It has many gradients.
For quiver A2, it's a crazy algebra.
Yeah, okay. For quiver A2, yeah, it's crazy, but that's what I wanted to say, that there are very few cases when it's known explicitly. Very few cases where it can be computed. I mean, and it's very sad because one of the motivations for introducing this was to absorb the ideas from physics, from, for example, from Harvey and Moore, and to construct what they call BPS algebra, algebra of BPS states. And there is a definition, but unfortunately, we cannot compute it in examples which are interesting for physicists. Yeah, that's okay. But anyway, what do we know? So if we have quiver with a trivial potential, then H, this cohomological whole algebra, is a shuffle algebra. So the product can be computed using the torus localization. For example, so because I need this example later, if I have a quiver with one vertex and loops, it's again, this is example from our paper, then the corresponding, let's call it like Qn, then this algebra, which is a shuffle algebra, but in fact it can be computed all the way to something which is known. So if n is even, for example, if there are no loops at all, it just, so then this is an infinite Grassmann algebra. And if n is odd, for example, a quiver with one loop and no potential, and the trivial potential, this is an infinite symmetric algebra. Again, the variables are graded, but okay, infinite symmetric algebra. Now, yeah, it's a vector space of polynomials in one variable. This is my next. Yes. For n equals zero, okay, so let me write it down explicitly because it's my main example. So it's an A1 quiver, which on the usual constructible whole algebra side, it corresponds to the Lie algebra SL2, and it's quantization of quantization of the plus half of SL2, it's a polynomial in one variable. Yeah. So there is just one nilpotent. A1, I mean just A1. You see, Sash, one point.
I see one point, but.
Okay, let me make it bigger. Okay. This is A1. It's. So it's an. But for cohomological whole, you see, the point is that as a vector space, it's a. It's a direct sum of equivariant cohomology of the point. So it's already, it's polynomial for each n. Yeah, so it's infinite dimensional. It has nothing to do with a conventional whole algebra. So it's very big.
What is the grade?
1, 3, 5, 7. Okay. Yes, okay, so if we have a symmetric quiver, it's kind of more general, if the number of arrows from I to J is equal to the number of arrows from J to I, then this is it's super commutative. Here it was proven free supercommute. So it's symmetric algebra of some graded vector space. Free supercommutative. It was proven by Sasha Efimov, and more recently, it was generalized by Ben Davison. So here the potential is trivial, and in Davison's story, it can be non-trivial. And for him, he needs a kind of what he called, I think, symmetric structure. It's an isomorphism of the quiver with a quiver with all arrows reversed. Yeah, so, but the result is the same. It's generalization of your story. So it's still supercommutative. And also, there is like a special computation in our paper where we have a Jordan quiver, which means a quiver with one vertex and potential which is polynomial of an arbitrary degree. So then depending on degree, the algebra, cohomological whole algebra is a tensor power of one of these. No, for any n,
yeah.
it's a tensor power of if you have a potential.
But one loop, I think you just.
Yeah, but it can be polynomial. You forgot your own paper, yeah. So it's too many things. Yeah.
I think it's power of the 6-degree algebra.
Yeah, tensor power of this. Ah, okay, sorry. Yeah, yeah. The one, yeah. So you remember, it's very good. Yeah, it's a power of this exterior algebra, yes. And actually, I think we proved it just for, not for for the sheaf of vanishing cycles, but then it's using the methods of Davison, it can be proven. For critical cohomology as well. So anyway, I think this is the end of kind of a reminder. And yeah, I can show. Yeah. So it's A2 quiver. It's this one. Okay. So in this case, the algebra is neither. It's not a supercommutative, and now we have two vertices, and for each vertex, we have. You see, it's a subquiver. So if we know the answer for the quiver with one point, so we know that inside we have infinite Grassmann algebra. So they sit inside, and there are non-trivial relations between these generators, which I don't remember, but I can look if you like. Would you like me to? But it will take some time for me to find it. Maybe I don't remember, something like minus eta j plus 1 xi equal to the product of. Okay, let me see. Symmetric, non-symmetric. No. Ah, no, yeah, here it is. Okay. I found it. Eta I xij, xij plus 1 eta I minus xij eta I plus 1. So these are free Grassmann and the only non-trivial relations, something like this. So, and actually, the corollary of this description is identity for it's for quantum five-term identity for the quantum dilogarithm when one considers generating functions for graded components. So, it's indeed it's an interesting example. Okay, now comes a question. So this is the end of of the reminder part. And actually two questions, two natural questions. So we introduced this cohomological whole algebras for the purposes of Mativek, Donaldson, Thomas theory, which I'm not going to talk about. But there are two questions which I believe are interesting. So first question is a natural representation theory for cohomological whole algebra. And as kind of a motivation, which I can even refer to one of the talks at this conference. Remember, there was a talk of Gukov at the beginning of the conference, and he mentioned something like that algebra of closed BPS states should act. It's kind of a Gukov talk on the space of open BPS states. Yeah. So, and if you look at his paper with Tosic, you will see pictures like this. So this represents an open BPS states, probably in some sense which should be understood. Physicists think about the maybe real analytic sheaves supported on surfaces with a boundary, which are complex analytic on the complement of the boundary with some boundary conditions. So there should be a moduli space of such, but this theory is yet to be developed. And so this is the open part, this is the closed. And this is a more familiar story, for example, in Richard Thomas talk. You heard this, heard about stable pairs. So he spoke about sheaves, pure sheaves supported on curves. This is classical story actually, some people still think that Donaldson Thomas theory is just counting ideal shifts. So it's something about shifts with one-dimensional supports and three collabial. So this is a sort of an action. If you smoothen this somehow, yeah, you still get something supported on the surface with a boundary, and then there should be an action. Yeah, of this part is understood better, and the candidate for this is a cohomological whole algebra, and this is geometrically not understood, but we can try to look algebraically what should be here, especially since in some geometric cases we can model we can model the space of closed BPS states in terms of equivalence with potential. So then, okay, this is the first problem, and actually I wanted to write down the second one on the same page. So, okay, and the second one is a double of cohomological whole algebra. So what do I mean by double? So people who are familiar with constructible whole algebra, they know that that whole algebra gives you the quantization of the nilpotent part, of how it was devoted, GQ plus just 1/2 of the Katz-Moodle algebra. You can add the zero part, but the construction of the whole thing, the whole quantum group, it requires some extra efforts, and I think it's still not very satisfactory. I mean, all the proposed solutions. So basically, even in constructible case, the whole algebra gives 1/2 of what we need. And the question is how to construct another half. Fortunately, we know the definition of the full thing which we want to get. It's a quantized Katz-Moody algebra. But in the case of cohomological whole algebra, we know 1/2, but we do not know what the whole thing is. So then the question is, are there any methods which allow us at least to guess what will be this double? Okay, and I think that these two questions, these two problems, they are connected. And in particular, studying the problem A, we can give some guess, at least in some cases, of what should be the double. And the idea is kind of a rough idea. It can be traced even in classical papers by Nakajima. So the idea to B, if we know the answer A. So recall that in one of his very first papers, Nakajima recovered the Heisenberg algebra by looking at certain Hecke operators acting on the cohomology of Hilbert scheme on C2, or you can take equivariant cohomology if you'd like. But the point was that he constructed two representations of the polynomial algebra of infinitely many variables. Two representations of the same algebra, which, as we know, in the end, they constitute 2/2 of infinite Heisenberg algebra. But to see the commutation relations, one has to go to the representation space to commute the representation operators, and what we get should be called, if we do not know any algebra and know just geometry, it should be called infinite Heisenberg algebra. So then we can try to do the same thing. We know what cohomological whole algebra is, so let's try to construct representations, some natural representations, but we would like to have kind of a two-type representations in the same space by erasing operators and by creation and annihilation operator. Then commuting, we get something twice bigger. And I don't know the general answer, so, but let me illustrate it in the case, kind of illustrate the idea. For A1 quiver. In that case, we know what cohomological whole algebra is, so we can recognize the answer. And the idea in general is to use, so in general, construct representations of cohomological whole algebra in cohomology spaces in cohomology of moduli of stable framed representations. So differently, similarly to this story with PT stable pairs, in that case we have smooth schemes, not stacks, so the cohomology are finite dimensional, so the representations can be handled. So how it works in the case of quiver A1? The framing, so the representations of such a quiver is given just by a vector space of arbitrary dimensions. So the framing is given by an extra vertex with a number of arrows. It's basically just a definition. I do not want to give a general definition. There is a very general definition of what the framing is. Stable framed representation. So which representations of the quiver should be called stable framed? So we put a one-dimensional vector space here, so we have a bunch of arrows. For example, let's consider just one arrow for simplicity. So then the representation to define this in general, for general quiver, what's a stable framed representation, one need to choose a stability structure, which in the case of quiver is just a stability function, which is the same as a bunch of points in the upper half plane. And then we have the notion of the slope stability in this case. So the representation of the quiver is called stable framed if there are no sub-representations which contain the image of this one-dimensional vector space under all arrows, and which has a slope which is bigger than the slope of the whole representation space. In the case of quiver A1, this is empty. So the only stability condition is a trivial one. So then basically stable frame representations are just surjective maps. So then the space of stable framed representations is isomorphic in each dimension to the Grassmannian thing, gamma d. It's a moduli of stable frame. And so we are looking for a representation In this case, there will be just finitely many summands. Of the infinite Grassmann algebra in this finite dimensional vector space. So, and then it's quite easy to see. So, this has a dimension 2 in the power d. And the basis vector, so basically, where we get such representations? We get them similarly to the definition of the product on cohomological whole algebra. We get them by considering short exact sequences. For example, we consider short exact sequence where two representations are stable framed and this one is arbitrary. Then again, we have three projections, 2E1, E2, and E3. And the pullback push-forward constructions give an action of the cohomology of this stack on the cohomology of this moduli space. So then we get a representation. In this particular case, we get a representation which is naturally realized in the finite dimensional quotient of this Grassmann algebra by the ideal. Consisting of or spanned by wedge products with more than d factors. No, it's finite dimensional. No. All possible. No, the basis of the quotient. Okay, maybe I just
all linear polynomials. If d is one, you have all linear polynomials in infinitely many variables, still infinite.
Maybe it's the last guy.
No, the last guy. Yeah, you are right. So
it would be generated by psi starting from d plus one.
From e1 starting from okay. E1 starting from d plus 1, I guess.
It means it's ideal generated by c d plus 1.
Okay, yeah, you're right. C d plus 1 and so on, yeah. So then indeed the basis will be just these things. You're right. K.
Where
K from 1 to d, I guess. Yeah. Agree? Okay. So the action is a natural one, so it's just the product. And similarly, we can project to the last factor, which gives us a kind of a creation operators, if you like. That's like this. And projecting on the last factor, this corresponds to the projection on the middle. Projection on the last factor gives annihilation operator, which is a contraction. So then, one can commute what we get in the end, what kind of representations we get. And the answer is that we get a representation of the Lie algebra, of the orthogonal Lie algebra. So then the natural guess is that the double cohomological whole algebra. In general, in this case, it's a Clifford algebra, infinite Clifford algebra, with two types of generators and the central element. So this is one half, this is one half. So this is infinite Grassmann, this is also infinite Grassmann. And this is a constant times one. Of course, when we consider finite dimensional representation, this finite dimensional story, then the central charge must go to zero. And of course, it's and it's naturally again to guess that if we have a quiver with n loops and no potential, then we have a similar story. If we have even number of loops, we have infinite Grassmann, infinite Clifford algebra. Even if we have odd number of loops, we have infinite Heisenberg algebra. So very much similar to the story with Nakajima. All right. So, and of course, one can ask where is the quiver A1. And if you look for the one half, you'll see that these xi's plus, they correspond to the positive part of the affine Lie algebra SL2 hat. So AY11 quiver. So maybe this is where the dependence on the quiver is hidden. So this plus one half, they in fact come from the corresponding affine Lie algebra. Okay, so do I have any time?
Theoretically not.
Theoretically not. Okay, so then, it's better to stop. I know that there is a Russian tradition that you cannot wish anything to a person before actual birthday date. And so for Maxim it will be in August, but we are in France, so I can break this tradition and wish you happy birthday, Maxim. So thank you.
Any questions to the speaker?